Oh God. This is gonna be terrible, folks. It's gonna be terrible. Don't hate me. You haven't even watched the video yet. You already hate me. Stop it. You haven't even heard what I had to say yet. Fuck, I don't know. Roll the intro. You guys are gonna tear me a new asshole. Frankly, I just need to stop caring. I do care that you guys enjoy the reviews, but I can't lie to you. And we're back. This is going to be rough. Stop rolling, battery. Son of a dick. Can't get this thing to... No matter how much I stall, eventually I will have to talk about it. Doesn't mean we can't try, though, right? Rick and Michonne return to the CRM to infiltrate it from within and to steal and or destroy the dossier. Immediately upon Rick's arrival back, they're saying, General Beale still wants to talk to you and to give you the echelon briefing. You know, in my mind, I'm overcomplicating the story. It's not hard to follow, really, at all. I'm overcomplicating it because I wish there was more to it. But there ain't. Yeah, so they get back. Michonne is infiltrating it, just like Rick is. Rick's getting the echelon briefing. Michonne is kind of sneaking into a movie theater and watching a PowerPoint, which also looks like an echelon briefing. But Rick's getting the echelon briefing. But now Michonne's getting the echelon briefing. Turns out Rick could have just snuck into one of these rooms at any point and gotten a briefing. Because how strange is it? Like, Beale even says, like, I've given this briefing to, like, 2,500 people. And all of the people I've given this to have never been you, Rick. Rick couldn't have infiltrated into one of these meetings? Like, why have the meeting happen at the same time? Why not have the echelon briefing that Beale gives Rick directly be all of that information? Why is there a side quest of Michonne going into the movie theater and her learning about it? She learned more than Rick did. She's been there for like 3 weeks and she knows more than Rick does. Damn it. Before I even get into this, I'm going to give kind of an overall assessment of my feelings about the episode through it. Just little short snippets, okay? So here's how it kind of went. It's okay. Okay, that's interesting. Oh, I didn't know if they were going to go that direction with it. This is good. Holy shit, it's great. Fuck, what a shit-ass way to end it. Damn it. I was talking to one of my friends who also watches The Walking Dead, and I was kind of describing it because they haven't gotten into The Ones Who Live yet. Not just yet. They were kind of waiting on my suggestion. If I thought it was good, then they would watch it. And they were like, how did you feel about the last episode? And I was just kind of joking about it, but I said, it's kind of like riding a roller coaster. And let's say like the one loop on the roller coaster is kind of towards the end of the roller coaster, just to give you one really big finish before the resolution, right? And you get up to the top of the loop and then you just fall out. And just fall and bang off the roller coaster onto the bottom and the ground and you're dead. You know, like the thing that they always wish wouldn't happen? I mean, because so many roller coasters could have these problems, but they don't. But it just so happens that the one that all of us are on right now did.
I believed.
This is why roller coasters have harnesses, okay? Is for shows just like this. Because the emotional roller coaster that we go on just for the bottom to drop out, you know what I mean? Right at the, you know, right at the 11th hour, right as we're a minute to midnight, and it literally blows up. And not in the way you wish it did. Not in the actual explosion, but the whole thing just goes up in flames. Damn it. Now I get why the motif of this show is fire. It's not because of Rick's story about how you have to let something burn in order for something to then grow, but because it's a dumpster fire. It is a wildfire out of control. I wish I was getting paid to watch this. Like, I really focused up and I was watching it and I was kind of into it, despite some of my difficulties being able to suspend my disbelief. I was enjoying it for the most part. Now, I will say this. Terry O'Quinn as General Beale, what a fucking waste. What a waste. Did they just get him in the show to do 10 takes? They advertised this guy like he was going to be the big bad. And in a way, in the story, he is. But we never see him. You know, like, imagine World War II, but we just never bring up Hitler. He's not that important to the story. I mean, sure, he's responsible for it. Sure. But we don't need to see him. People are going to say, what a ridiculous comparison. Do some research. I went to school when they actually taught kids about World War II. So go do your research. I feel like I'm having an out-of-body experience. I was watching the show, and I was in my body. And then there was a point where my soul just left my body and has yet to return. I'm just a vessel here. My body is the one setting up the camera and the lights and the microphone and stressing about it, but not me. I'm up in the ether, waiting to return to my body. Damn it. Fuck. So he gets the briefing, and during it, Beale says, like, put your gun and your prosthetic with the weapon closer to me than it is to you. Because they're trying to show that Beale is smart. He knows a thing or two because he's seen a thing or two. Farmers.
We are farmers. Bum, 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 bum.
And so what then he does is he puts his sword, the one that he gave the speech about, closer to Rick. And he basically says to Rick, I see you being me in the next 10 years. I don't know how much longer I have left on this planet. I don't know how much longer any of us have, but I think the next person who can take us into the next century is you, Rick. You could lead these people. I wasn't sure how to feel about you, Grimes. But now I see, after all the escapes, after whatever conversations that we've had, the fact that you had the opportunity to leave and returned, you believe in this place, like I believe in this place. And you are fit to lead. You are willing to do the difficult things to get the job done. And they have a little bit of a moment where he's like, hey, you want to take a sip of that Kool-Aid now? And then Rick goes, no. And then throws a knife, and it hits Beale, like, in the chest. Then Rick lunges, and they have a fight. They have a cool little Jaime Lannister moment. He, like, blocks that. I didn't mind that. We still got the, you know, him using the sword on Beale, and I like that it went through the hand and then stabbed him. Like, there were some things about this that I really liked. And I liked Rick's energy, and the acting was really top-notch on Andrew Lincoln's part. He was saying a lot without saying a lot. Acting. Terry O'Quinn was saying everything, and I felt like it was kind of a mediocre performance from him. Okay, long gone are the days of him on the show Lost, and it was just must-see TV, and he just carried this gravitas about him. I don't know. I think it's because Terry O'Quinn doesn't seem like the type of guy who would even watch The Walking Dead. So maybe he just didn't understand his place. I mean, he's a serviceable actor. Okay? He did his part. But did he add anything special to it? No. Did they show him on screen for a lot of time? No. I think in the entire show, he had less than 10 minutes of screen time. And the fact that they had set him up to be the main guy in charge, I mean, to me, that's just kind of unacceptable. Take out some of the stupid Jadis scenes, take out some of the stupid Thorn scenes, and give them to Beale. Give them to Beale. Let us have more one-on-ones with Rick and Beale. Why is that so hard? Shouldn't be. It isn't. I guarantee you, they wanted to do that. But the writers go, hey man, we're paying these actors a lot to act. And if we have to pay them if they're in the episode for 2 seconds or 15 minutes, let's have them in there closer to 15 minutes, okay? Because we have to pay them the same. Might as well get some use out of them. So instead of this nice dialogue between these two people, let's have a trialogue. Let's have everybody come in and talk. You know, it's just muddying the waters for no reason. After Rick kills Beale, I was really kind of into the fact that he put him in this trunk and he's like wheeling him around. I was like, this is so fucked up, I really like it. You know what I mean? Like, this is the kind of shit that The Walking Dead needs to do. It's just like, yeah, these characters are willing to do anything. I mean, Rick punched a head, a severed head, to make it look like Gregory 10 years ago. At this point, after he's chopped off his own hand, he'll do some fucked up shit, okay? And they had good use of tension in the elevator when they're like slowly going in this slow elevator and it's dinging and there's blood dripping and Rick is trying to make sure that this other CRM soldier doesn't see that it's dripping, and then they get in a fight. And then when Rick starts punching him with the bad hand, like just the prosthetic, and it just caves this dude's face in. Super, super satisfying. And then he went on to use that guy. So it's kind of like a Chekhov's walker. There's a rule called Chekhov's gun that if you see a gun on the table, you have to use that gun in terms of like storytelling. It's the same thing. We saw, like, right before Jadis got the axe thrown into her last episode, we saw it on the floor and she kind of kicks it away. And then as Michonne and Rick are escaping, Michonne picks up that exact axe and tosses it and hits her with it. Chekhov's hatchet. Look it up, people. I'm not nuts. So they wheel her there. Michonne is looking for the dossier. She finds it in the cat. I kind of like the aesthetic of Jadis's bedroom being all covered in artwork. That's good storytelling without saying it. It's like, oh my God, will you look at that? She still paints. That's all. I didn't need anything else. I'm glad they didn't push it. They didn't leave like a voice recorder that Michonne listened to, like she's in the movie Saw, like, I'd like to play a game. You know, like, I'm glad that shit was the end of it. She finds it. She reads it. I like the quick flashes of her kind of assessing the letter and that look on Danai's face of like, holy shit, Rick was right. She actually did write this dossier. She really was going to turn them in and people would have found it and they did need to come back to do this. So despite how we are getting the characters to these points, I like that they are acquiring information. It really did feel like Mission Impossible or like a James Bond film for a little while, okay? You know, infiltrating from within. That shit is great. I feel like that's what this entire season should have been, is that. And some people are going to say, what, are you fucking stupid? Yeah, that's exactly what they were doing the entire season. Well, I mean, you shouldn't have even watched this show. You don't even like the show. It's like, no, they didn't. No, they fucking did not. They didn't do that until this episode, okay? They showed elements of it, but they never showed this kind of clever escape. Actually, you know what? I take that back. They did it in episode 3, okay? When Rick was trying to get Michonne to leave, they did it then. They took their time, too much time, if you ask me. They should have been as fast-paced as this last episode is. Because this last episode was moving. I'll at least give it that. It didn't feel like anything was dragging. That's good. It felt like the story was moving somewhere. Okay. Dossier. Speech. Killed Beale. Wheeled him out in a box. Grabbed the other guy. Throw him in the box. Show him and Michonne hooking up a bunch of grenades that they had found. And she's kind of wiring them like Nat did. Good callback to that character. That was nice and appreciated. I felt like that character was present in her actions. Good job. They wire all of it up, and you find out pretty quickly that they are wiring it to where they are going to have the walkers basically pull the pins on all of these grenades, which are surrounded by all of the missiles of this particular CRM outpost. In an effort to kill the 3,000 people that are gathered around for a speech that General Beale is late to. So everybody's just sitting in chairs. They're not really like guns at the ready. They're not in a marching formation. They're just sitting in chairs. There's a really nice moment where basically like Thorn is weak, okay? Thorn was weak this entire time. It's really unfortunate, okay? I'm sorry, I just didn't buy it. I don't know if it's the acting or the writing of that character. I think the writing has always been weak on that character. They knew that they needed somebody to catch them in the act. They had Thorn. They set it up for Thorn. I just didn't buy it. I don't know. There was something there that was keeping me from being invested in Thorn. It would have been nice if I really, really liked Thorn and knew that she was right or something, or knew that she was a good person and was going to meet her untimely demise. So the whole time that you're watching her do this, you're going, oh my God, she's going to confront our characters. They're going to try to save her and she's going to end up dying anyway. You know, drama. I don't know what to say. Really good, tense part of the episode. Thorne's got the drop on both of them. Tells them to take their helmets off. Basically says, go undo what you just did. So she is still holding out hope that they can fix whatever they fucked up. And they are walking back to where they set the walkers up, and they can start to hear the walkers get louder and louder. And they are very aware that they might be walking towards their death, because the pins are getting pulled on these grenades. This is a really good couple, power couple moment. The moment Beale starts to exit and they split, the one part that's weak about this, okay, I'm talking about the stuff that I like here. The one part that's weak about this is Michonne just going like, quick, run over here. There's a jug of water. She slices it and then grabs a tarp, throws the tarp over them, and the water pours on them. And then all of the missiles and shit explode simultaneously, releasing a bunch of mustard gas and releasing what looks like this equivalent of a small atomic bomb. And then, like those classic 1950s nuclear explosion drill videos that they used to play at schools, like the children hiding under their desks. That's kind of how it felt. It's like, hey man, hiding underneath water during an explosion, water would turn to steam. It would burn you. It would broil you at the very least, okay? But acting like, you might as well have had them like hiding in a snowbank and the snow didn't melt. You know what I mean? Like that's just so... I'm suspending my disbelief. You know why? Because they fucking nuked the CRM basically. And that shit, I mean, I legitimately went, oh, you know what I mean? Like I liked it. I like that quite a bit. Okay, but here's the thing. Thorne has no idea what's taking place. She has no mask on and she is standing about 100 feet from this explosion. Comparable to the explosion in Game of Thrones Season 6, The Sept of Baelor. Okay? Comparable to that. And somehow, instead of her lifeless fucking skeleton being a fucking shadow that is burned into the wall, that would have been some nice imagery in The Walking Dead. Instead of that, she's fine. She's got a mask on. She was able to see Beale coming out, grab a mask, survive a massive explosion that would surely deafen you, burn you, char your entire corpse, send you flying into the next county. She survives all of that. But hey, I'm supposed to go, well, you know what? If Rick and Michonne live, then so should Thorne. Damn it. But that's what I'm saying. Just have Rick and Michonne outrun it. They had enough time to get away. Okay, I don't know. Have them jump down a hill and roll, and then the explosion happens, and they escape it by the skin of their teeth, and Thorne is just incinerated. Okay, she is just Dr. Manhattan'd, just dematerialized. I would have loved to have seen it, because let me tell you, the subsequent fight between Michonne and Thorne was horribly choreographed, contrived, unnecessary. It should have been Thorne's time to join their side. If you're gonna do anything, come back to fucking Alexandria with us. You gave up looking for your family, now you don't have to. Tell me that wouldn't have been better. Tell me, I mean, you just watched the entire thing go up in smoke literally right in front of you. Your boss, all of the henchmen, all of the people who trapped you, tortured you, and made you give up your life are dead. You are free to leave, soldier. And she doesn't. And I just, yeah, I'm aware. I'm aware that she said, you know, in a lifeless world, love is dead or something like that. I know. I watched it.
In a dead world, love is dead.
Damn it. Michonne's giving this long-winded speech after stabbing her. She should have stabbed her and then just went to go look for Rick immediately. No, like, saying one cool badass line. I'm sorry, dude. It's not an 80s movie. It's not a Seagal movie.
I'ma take you to the bank, Senator Trent. To the blood bank.
Bam, 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 bam. You know what I mean? Like, thank God I wasn't watching with commercials. Because I guarantee there was a commercial there. And that, if there wasn't, I mean, oh my God. Just, fuck you. That whole thing just pissed me off. There's supposed to be more realism, and now not only did they survive an explosion, and she knows that Rick's life is in danger, Rick is cornered by like 10 walkers, and we see Rick pull a pin on a grenade, and looks like he drops down or throws it underneath them, or I don't know, and all these walker guts and shit explodes out the way that he was just trapped. And Michonne sees it, and she looks like she lost him all over again. It's like season 7, the episode where they saw that terrible CGI deer, and Rick hides underneath like a crate or something like that in a carnival area. I'll show a fucking clip. It was like that moment all over again. She basically gave up her will to live and then realized that Rick was alive. And then they get away. And we don't see them get away. This is where the episode went to shit. That's the nice way of me saying it. It went to shit. The narration saying, like, the CRM has fallen, and now everybody is welcome to go back. Citizens are welcome to go back to their homes and just forget that all of it even happened. Hey! Damn it. What? Huh? Why? The CRM's not going to look into this at all. Hey, you know what? We looked into it, and our bad. Sorry about that. I mean, who the fuck is narrating this? Everything's coming up Milhouse here in The Walking Dead. Damn it. I mean, like, it wouldn't have been any worse if they were just like, here comes the sun, do-do-do-do. Like, it might as well just fuck it. Fuck it. We didn't even get, like, a cool space junk or anything like that. Imagine if Thorne had sided with them, and they're standing on that thing, and they look at each other, and they just kind of go, like, you know, we are the ones who live. And then all of a sudden, just the fucking helicopter comes down and it's Thor just going, get in! You want to go home, right?
Yeah.
I don't know why she sounds Mexican the way that I'm doing it, but you know what? Her accent is probably the worst South African accent I've ever heard, even though she is from South Africa, which I found out. That's like meeting a British person who's like, hello, love, I just wanted to pop off for the moment. You know, like, it sounds ridiculous.
I don't really go for that sort of thing. Hello, love, we're the ones who live, yeah?
It's like Dick Van Dyke British accent. Like, what if you found out that was actually Dick Van Dyke's voice? In Mary Poppins, that was his actual voice. What then? What would Great Britain do if that was actually how he talked? That's how I feel with Thorne. Damn it. The narration was terrible. That's like the Brian Regan joke when he is like, when writers go, you know, when one thing led to the other. What kind of lazy ass writing is that? Isn't it your job as a writer to tell me how this led to that? It's a great bit. Adolf Hitler was a young man who got rejected from art school. One thing led to the other, and two atomic bombs were dropped on the sovereign nation of Japan. That's how this felt. It was like, hey, one thing led to the other, and it's okay. Rick and Michonne step off of a helicopter in a field. Rick is kind of wearing, like, the new, I don't know, they stop by a JCPenney's on the way to Alexandria, and they just go, like, hey, I'm gonna still wear my old boots, but I need some new threads. They step off, and who do we see coming running over the hill? Choto, and a kid who shouldn't be an actor, coming right towards them. Look, everybody, it's Judith and RJ. I was let down in more ways than one. This is supposed to be a great moment. Judith still looks like Judith. Unfortunately, they did not recast RJ with a kid who gives a fuck and who isn't a sociopath. Damn it. This kid is unnerving. I'm going to play his last two lines on repeat like 5 or 6 times throughout this review. It is disturbing the lack of emotion that kid delivers his lines with.
I knew you'd come back. I believed.
It is disturbing. Don't you fucking tell me, audience, that is a good actor, that is a good delivery, and that motherfucking talentless child should have the last two lines in The Ones Who Live.
I knew you'd come back. I believed.
Are you fucking kidding me? What, did you bang your fucking head against the wall? You know, have you been huffing too many Sharpies in your spare time? That kid fucking sucks.
I knew you'd come back. I believed.
Andrew Lincoln's giving a performance, but even his performance is marred because of how terrible that fucking child is. You got the Judith actress who's going on to do other things. She's becoming Casey Fleming or whatever her name is. I think that's what it is. Casey Fleming. There's no point in memorizing RJ's name. Don't even memorize it. Hell, forget RJ. Not just his real name, forget his character name, forget everything about it. If RJ had just slowly disappeared, like Back to the Future style in the middle of the last scene, he just starts to fade away, like Rick pulls up his phone, and it just like changes, like Back to the Future, like, hey, things actually got better, not worse. I would have been fine with it, because anything would have been better than this last 5 minutes. The dialogue of this was just not good, okay? It just straight up wasn't good. It doesn't matter how good these fucking actors are if you fuck them in the ass with this dialogue. And you fuck them hard. I mean, fuck, you just shoved one of those grenades that Michonne found right up their ass.
Universe gives you a sign and you just shove your finger right up its ass.
I'm very disappointed because I was genuinely enjoying this episode. I was suspending my disbelief. I was enjoying it. I thought Rick was acting well. I thought Denai was acting well. I liked that they were focused. They had a direction. We knew where they were going. You get this, I get that. We learn this, we learn that. We kill him, we kill her, we get out, we go home. You did all of those things right. But the part where you lacked, the part that is arguably the most important part, is Rick and Michonne are returning home after being gone the better part of a decade. And they're met with that.
I knew you'd come back. I believed.
You guys are gonna tear me a new asshole. Frankly, I just need to stop caring. I do care that you guys enjoy the reviews, but I can't lie to you. I really can't. I'm genuinely disappointed. I didn't think that they could fit even what they fit in to this last episode in there. And that ending, that really showed it. That really showed it. You know what would have been maybe a good idea? Is we get to that and they say it's the finale. And AMC just goes, just kidding. They end it on the explosion or something like that. And they go, next week on AMC's The Walking Dead, The Ones Who Live. And there's another secret seventh episode. Lucky number seven. How great would that be? A whole episode devoted to them getting back home. Further escaping. Further explanation of what's really happening with the CRM. Not in narration, in practice. In practice. We can actually see it. And they come back. And they get a different fucking RJ. And then they end. Let's give some numbers. Acting in this episode, overall, 8.5. Andrew Lincoln and Denai, I felt like they were kind of in the 8.5, 9. Terry O'Quinn, 7.5, 8. Thorne, probably one of her better episodes. I'd give her an 8. Just personally. I know the last episode I gave her like a 7 or something like that. The writing. The first 3/4 of the episode up until the explosion, I'll give that an 8.5. The subsequent, after the explosion, the last quarter of the episode, 3. And that sucks, dude. I hate that. I don't just hate that for me. I hate that for you. Do you guys realize out there that I want you to enjoy this show? I know that you think that I'm shitting on it because I'm trying to convince you not to like it. These are just my fucking opinions. I want us all to have a good show. But I want an actually good show. Not a show that I lie to myself and go, that's good because I'm saying it's good. I just want it to be factually good. Action, great. 9. I'll say 9. Action was a 9. For me, I was satisfied with it. Even the little actions of just putting Beale in a box and wheeling him around and just the notion that that's what they're doing. I mean, I thought that was good. Cinematography, good. Not as good as some of the first couple of episodes, but still good. I think the reason it was a little bit different is because they knew that they were going to have so many visual effects in it that they used slightly different cameras that might give them more information, like more pixels and stuff in the screen, so that they could, you know, add more effects and stuff like that later, which sometimes can cause the image to look a little bit different. You know, if you're just going for something that's like really pretty and clean, you might use this camera. And then if you're going for something for more like function or slow-mo and stuff like that, sometimes they use different ones. Just saying. Not sure. I'm not going to look into it. I'm just saying. Let's talk briefly about this. I have not done it for the other episodes, but this one I wanted to see the episode Insider. The part at the end of the episode where Andrew Lincoln and Danai Gurira and Scott Gimple are talking about The Walking Dead. And I'm just going to say, I think Scott Gimple is delusional in terms of what he created. And Andrew Lincoln, I think, really does give a shit about this story. And I do not feel like he was heard. Okay? Because at the end he's like, and I wanted it to end with, you know, a God's eye view just panning out on this nice moment, because I wanted the reunion. I really wanted that. And we got the reunion. We did not pan out to a God's eye view. So immediately, I mean, I'm shocked that they even left that in the interview, because they didn't do that. They just backed out. But that's not a God's eye view. A God's eye view is aerial. It's space junk from the first episode of The Walking Dead. That is a God's eye view. Oh yeah. Good on Andrew Lincoln and Danai Gurira for being producers. I think undoubtedly they probably did help with some of the smaller things that do not go unnoticed. I don't know exactly what they had their hands on specifically in terms of the story and the production of it, but I have a strong feeling that they are a reason that this was shot better and had better sound and better effects and things like that. I think that they were a big part of that. I think that they would have refused to do it if it wasn't as good as it is. I think the blame falls on Scott Gimple, not the actors. And other producers who let this happen this way. It's unfortunate. It's not what I wanted, but it is what it is, man. I would say overall, the first three quarters of the episode, 8.5. The last quarter, 3. Add it together, you get 11.5. Divided by 2, you get 5.75. That's how important an ending is. It doesn't matter if you start off weak or if you start off strong. It only matters how you close. And you petered to a stop. This car blew a gasket, quite literally, and then sputtered to a stop. And seized up, never to be driven again. I'm disappointed, man. I keep saying that. I mean, it really was how rushed it got towards the end there, and just the yada yadaing and skipping over stuff. I mean, that was Game of Thrones season 8. Let's go to King's Landing. Here we are. You know what I mean? Like, it's that kind of shit. Jetpacking around and whatever. Wrapping it up. Characters just, damn. But let me say this. I'm going to make a full video devoted to talking about the season overall as a whole. Things I might have improved, things that I would have cut out, just so it doesn't seem like I'm just hating to hate, okay? I want to do that. I want time to let this marinate a little bit so that I can come up with some ideas, all right? Doesn't mean that obviously the show's going to change, it is what it is, but I just want you guys to know that I do love The Walking Dead. I do not like where it is gone, but I stuck it out. There can be people who hate my opinions, but you know what? They don't seem to mind when other people quit after season 7, episode 1. Those people quit watching all Walking Dead shows, and I have stuck it out. I've watched this, I've watched The World Beyond, I watched Fear the Walking Dead, I watched Daryl Dixon, I watched Negan's. I have the right to say what I'm saying. I really do. It is not baseless. If you love this episode, and you disagree with me, fair to you. Good on you, fair play. Leave a comment below telling me what you loved and why you loved it. You don't have to sway me and get me to come over to your side. Just explain what you liked. I like reading other people's ideas because sometimes I agree with people. And I go, you know what? I didn't think of it like that. This is just cold off the top of my head. Okay, so I'm sorry if in 3 months I feel differently, or in 5 years I feel differently. This is how I feel right at this moment. It's honest, it's guttural, it's instinctual, it's visceral, it is now. And it's subject to change. But trust me, I do not feel at this moment like The Walking Dead, The Ones Who Live, is gonna age like fine wine. I just got a feeling
it ain't gonna happen. No.
Nah.
I hardly do not believe that that's gonna happen. I know what it isn't. It ain't right.
No! Don't worry, we're gonna talk more about this.
Our story isn't done. Not for a long shot. And we will be back, I know it. I know it.
So please, do me a favor. If you got to this portion of the video, you're a rock star. Drop a like, leave a comment, what you liked, what you didn't like. If you agree, if you disagree. Do you want to kill me like Spencer? Or you want to love on me like Eugene? Tell me. Also, don't forget to hit the subscribe button and ring the bell icon so you never miss an upload. Thanks so much, you guys.
I'm on my way from misery to happiness, song.
Damn it.
George, what he did, help is on the way!